I'm Dr. Vasant Nagvekar, a consultant in infectious disease at Global Hospital and Leelavati Hospital, Parel, Bandra in Mumbai city. So today I'm going to talk to you about the importance of antimicrobial stewardship program and why it is so badly required in India about. And exactly there, you can see from the screen that why I'm talking about antimicrobial stewardship is because by 2050, antimicrobial resistance will be responsible to around 10 million deaths annually. That's a huge number. And the main reason for antimicrobial resistance, or the reason why you should have an antimicrobial stewardship program to prevent antimicrobial resistance, is to, because of inappropriate antibiotic, there are a lot of drug-drug interactions which happen, a lot of adverse effects for no reason, a lot of usage of antibiotics which are not required, using of high-end antibiotics, the cost of the therapy, the stay of the hospitalization, and subsequently, because of misuse of antibiotics, the selection and rapid emergence of drug-resistant bacteria. So WHO has reported that 76% of the respondents from India took antibiotics in the past 6 months. Factors specifically contributing to multi-drug-resistant microbes are indiscriminate use of antibiotics. For simple community-acquired infections, I've seen people using meropenem and high-end antibiotic teicoplanin, where it could be a viral infection or it could be a community-acquired sepsis, simple pneumonias or UTIs, where you don't really require big guns to treat them. So that's why indiscriminate use of antibiotic, easy availability, and so there's nobody to check on them. Who there's nobody to guard. Who is using what antibiotic? And that's why your antimicrobial stewardship program, when it comes into picture, there is a like in Global Hospital, we have a restricted antibiotic form where we have carbapenems, colistin, fosfomycin, ceftazidime, bactrim, at least the gram negatives, where, and also we have started the antifungal stewardship. So there, we cannot restrict not using antibiotics to anybody. So in ICU and all that, we allow the consultants to use the antibiotic, but within 24 hours or 48 hours, my pharmacologist and infection control nurse goes and fills up the form, and the doctors fill the form, antimicrobial stewardship form, why it has been, why they are using these antibiotics, and then if it is not really indicated, the forms are screened by me, and then I have a dialogue with them if it's not required, or my pharmacologist goes and tells them this is not required, you can use de-escalate to this antibiotic, or it's not required if it's a viral infection to discontinue the antibiotic. So that's what we do in as the antimicrobial stewardship form is there, where we have a restricted antibiotic, what we do. So basically, the goals of antimicrobial stewardship program are optimizing antimicrobial regimen, reducing the healthcare cost, reducing the antibiotic-induced collateral damage incidence. For example, suppose some patients of urosepsis is admitted with an ESBL E. coli, which is sensitive to your cefepime-Sulbactam or ertapenem, and the patient has been put on meropenem. So meropenem per day cost is around 10,000 or maybe more than that per day. And if you have to give it for 10 to 14 days, it costs around 10, it costs around almost 1 lakh to 1.5 lakhs only on the medicine cost. Apart from the doctor or hospital cost, it goes much higher. The same thing, you can put the patient on simple ertapenem and 1 gram, and patient can be discharged, which the cost would come to around 2 to 3,000 rupees, and the patient can be discharged home. So he saves so much of the money, not only monetary, but also he's saving the hospitalization cost. So it's a win-win situation. Also, third thing is there is no resistance, which collateral damage which will occur. So that's why it's very, very important that a very strong antimicrobial stewardship program be there in each and every secondary and tertiary care centers, which will really help to reduce the antimicrobial resistance. So here are a few antimicrobial stewardship interventions that I recommend for solving the antimicrobial resistance crisis. So a strong antibiogram. So every monthly we have an infection control meeting, and where an antibiogram is presented to the all the consultants, the head of departments, to what is the pattern of resistance in the hospital. Say for example, different ICUs in the same hospital may have a different antibiogram. So that is being projected. And also another thing is very important is the access watch and reserve tool. This is partly what I spoke just now about access categories, which simple antibiotics which can be given. Watch category is where you use, say, like carbapenems and all that. And reserve category is where I said colistin, fosfomycin, ceftazidime, bactrim, high-end antibiotics only with specific consultation or after 48 hours only, if the ID consultant or a senior physician says then only to continue the drug. So this indiscriminate use of antibiotics can be stopped. And the third important thing is very important is the diagnostic tools. I think in my antimicrobial stewardship form in Global Hospital, which we are conducting, there are two columns, like what is the site you are targeting, what are the organisms you are targeting, and whether you sent adequate cultures. Like, have you sent two sets of blood culture? Have you sent a urine culture? Or if you're thinking that this is a ventilatory associated pneumonia, have you sent ET secretions for culture before starting an antibiotic? Because it's very important to send culture should be the culture, I would say, to have a beginning of the antimicrobial stewardship program. Because only once your cultures are positive and it shows a particular organism and sensitivity, then you can think about whether you have to de-escalate or escalate the antibiotic. So that's very, very important. So that's what about your antimicrobial stewardship program consists of. So for an antimicrobial stewardship program, you require to have an antimicrobial stewardship team, which is the infection control nurse, the pharmacologist, the ID consultant, the intensivist. All of them have to be a strong part of the team. It cannot be driven by a single person. And the most important thing is, even if all of us have a desire to run the antimicrobial stewardship program, unless the facility director, that means the CEO of the hospital, has a vision to restrict antibiotics and to prevent antimicrobial resistance, then only things will work. Like, suppose if the CEO is not interested so much, then the consultant will ask, who are you to tell us ki stop the antibiotic? But the CEO should be very strong to say that no, we have to have this program strong in the hospital to prevent the antimicrobial resistance, and that is only possible by a strong antimicrobial stewardship program. And apart in diagnostic tools, as I said, the blood cultures, the rapid diagnostic tests, all those are very, very important part again of a very strong antimicrobial stewardship program. I think apart from this antimicrobial stewardship forms, another very important part of antimicrobial stewardship, I would, if you ask me, is a surgical site prophylaxis. Also, the surgeons, what you're using as a antibiotics when they're operating is also a very strong part of surgical as a part of antimicrobial stewardship, which we are monitoring. And the third thing is, without strong infection control practices, you cannot have a strong antimicrobial stewardship. So your environment has to be, I would say, infection control practices form the most major part of the antimicrobial stewardship program, where you have to have a very good hand hygiene data, hand hygiene practices in the hospital. You have to, I would say, promote hand hygiene practices across consultants, doctors, everybody. That's very, very important. You have to have your environment clean. That is, you have to see that the thorough deep cleaning or environmental cleaning is being done. So that's very important part. I would say infection control practices form a very, very important part of antimicrobial stewardship program. One step ahead in Global Hospital, what we are doing is any patient who's admitted for more than 48 hours in another hospital, we keep them in contact isolation and we send a perirectal swab for carbapenem resistant enterobacteria, whether he's harboring or whether he's colonized with that. Till then, he's kept on contact isolation. Again, this is also a very important part of the antimicrobial stewardship program. But to be in short, I would say antimicrobial stewardship program consists of restricting the antibiotic, using the right drug, right dose, right duration, and right de-escalation. These are four Ds, which are very, very important. Having a good microbiological workup, restricting the antibiotics, and having a very strong infection control practices, having a very good surgical site prophylaxis where misuse should not be happening. And very important is de-escalation whenever possible to narrow down to the narrowest spectrum drug, which is possible, and where it's not required for viral infection, not to use antibiotics. And where we can switch over from injectables to oral and discharge the patient as early as possible. This is what is important as an antimicrobial stewardship program. So with this, I would end my lecture, and I would say this the way to forward to tackle the antimicrobial resistance in India. And if you want to preserve your drugs, antibiotics, you have to have a very strong antimicrobial stewardship program in your hospital. Thank you. Thank you.